Be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Merciful Father, you sent your only begotten Son, who by his life and parables taught us about your fatherly love. Make us worthy to celebrate today your great mercy, as revealed in the parable of the prodigal son, who repented and returned to his father. Like him, bring us back from the exile of sin to your fatherly house, that we may glorify you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children. Let us raise glory, honor, and praise to the merciful Father, who loves all people and accepts their repentance, and to the beloved Son, who became man and invited all people to his Father's house, and to the Holy Spirit, who enlightens our hearts and consciences. To the good one be glory and honor on this blessed Sunday and all the days of our lives now and forever.
Amen.
O Christ our God, you are the true light who has come into the world. You are the way that leads to the Father, and no one comes to the Father except through you. You showed us your love when you lived among us, and you told us of the Father's compassion and his love for repentant sinners. You spoke to us of repentance, of mercy, and of living water. Today we meditate on the parable of the prodigal son, who, trusting his father, turned from his life of corruption and repented of his sin. Now, O Lord, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense to have compassion upon us, as you have compassion on all sinners. May we humble ourselves before you and repent of our sins. Enlighten us that we may know you. Strengthen us with your power and do not turn your holy face away from us, lest darkness of sin surround us. Send your Spirit to us, sinners, during this forgiving season of Lent, so that we may return to you seeking forgiveness. Open your blessed arms to us and bring us close to you, so that we may meet you with joy and find happiness in knowing you. Be our strength and our help, that we may glorify you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit forever. For the forgiveness of our sins. May those who have strayed from your fatherly house return there, that they may ask for pardon and forgiveness. As for us, your weak children, strengthen our resolve to remain with you and glorify you forever.
Amen.
Kadishat aloho kadishat hayatono kadishat lo yuhato itrohan.
I have sinned against heaven and before you, said the Son. Though my heart now condemns me, you are greater than my heart.
Lord,
you accepted what the just man offered you. Now accept in your mercy our pure sacrifice and praise.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians.
Glory to the Lord of Paul and the apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish and her children forever.
Brothers and sisters, examine yourselves to see whether you are living in faith. Test yourselves. Do you not realize that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless, of course, you fail the test. I hope you will discover that we have not failed, but we pray to God that you may not do evil. Not that we may appear to have passed the test, but that you may do what is right, even though we may seem to have failed. For we cannot do anything against the truth, but only for the truth. For we rejoice when we are weak, but you are strong. What we pray for is your improvement. I am writing this while I am away, so that when I come, I may not have to be severe in virtue of the authority that the Lord has given me to build up and not to tear down. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Mend your ways. Encourage one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the holy ones greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Praise be to God always. I will get up and go to my Father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before.
For the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior, announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Peace be with you. From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Luke, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The Lord Jesus says, a man had two sons, and the younger son said to his father, Father, give me the share of your estate that should come to me. So the father divided the property between them. And after a few days, the younger son collected all his belongings and set off to a distant country, where he squandered his inheritance on a life of dissipation. When he had freely spent everything, a severe famine struck that country, and he found himself in dire need. So he hired himself out to one of the local citizens, who sent him out to his farm to tend the swine. And he longed to eat his fill from the pods on which the pigs fed, but nobody gave him any. And coming to his senses, he thought within himself, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough food to eat, but here I am, dying from hunger. I shall get up, and I shall go to my father, and I shall say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. Treat me as you would one of your hired laborers.' So he got up, and he went back to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father caught sight of him. And filled with compassion, he ran out to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. And his son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son.' But his father ordered his servants, 'Quickly, bring the finest robe and place it on him, and put a ring on his finger and sandals upon his feet. And then take the fattened calf and slaughter it. Let us then celebrate with a feast, because this son of mine was dead and has returned to life again. He was lost, and he has been found.' And then the celebration began. Now the older son had been out in the field, and on his way back, as he neared the house, he heard the sound of music and dancing. He called one of the servants, and he asked what this might mean. And the servant said to him, 'Your brother has returned, and your father has slaughtered the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' And he became angry, and he refused to enter the house. So his father came out and pleaded with him. And he said to his father in reply, 'Look, all these years I have served you, and not once have I disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat to feast upon with my friends. But when this, your son, returns, who swallowed up your property with prostitutes, for him you slaughter the fattened calf.' And he said to him, 'My son, you are here with me always. Everything I have is yours. But now we must celebrate and rejoice, because your brother was dead and has come to life again. He was lost, and he has been found.' This is the truth. Peace be with you. Try yourselves. If you be in the faith, prove yourselves. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This section that we have is from the very ending of the letter of St. Paul. So the letter to the Corinthians, as we've often spoken about, is filled with a lot of cantankerous exchanges because of the difficulties going on at the parish in Corinth. And so at the very end of this second letter, St. Paul is saying, now prove, try yourself. So the word try and the word prove, they've kind of missed some of their original meaning. I mean, now prove means win the argument and, or otherwise punch the other guy. But proving is not that. Proving means testing. Show. Remember when we used to be tortured in geometry? You learned all the proofs, the Euclidean proofs. And so that's the proof. And what St. Paul is saying at the end of these two letters is he's saying, try yourself, prove yourself. Show that Christ is truly dwelling within you. Unless, of course, you're reprobates. Adokimoi. Unless you have been rejected. And so he leaves it with this idea of understanding. And he says, I'd even want to have you show that Christ is truly working with you, even if it made me and us look like reprobates. I would accept that opprobrium as long as you yourselves live this life of Christ. And to remember over these weeks, especially during the Great Lent, we've been trying to consider the fact that Christianity is not about a great teacher of humanity who gave us an ethical system of morality. That is not the gospel. The gospel is that God himself has entered into our world to become man, and in becoming man to invite and allow us to be engrafted into that incarnational reality, so that the whole process of what the Greeks call theosis, and what we call divinization, and what we call also in the Syriac the mingling, that the mingling, the transformation, be the collaboration between God's invitation of grace and the individual asceticism in return. It's a collaboration between God and man. And again, when I say asceticism, it doesn't mean you're scourging yourself or whatever, or even fasting. Askesis in the Greek means effort. It means we're responding to that invitation, and in that collaboration, in that effort, in that askesis, God creates something new. The individual who is then able to become whom they were meant to be by God's creation and his love from all eternity. That's the very simple vision. And that's why St. Paul at the end of this letter says, now try yourself, prove, show that Christ is truly working within you, transforming you into the reality, a living reality of the Sacred Heart. And so it's really, in a sense, when we first read it, we think, okay, so he's throwing this out, but it's not rhetorical. He's really saying, enter into this reality of the gospel. Now, what's interesting is that many people have made comments already on our Lenten icon that we have on our tetrapod up front. Somebody once said the icon on the thing out there. The thing we call a tetrapod, it's just Greek for four-footed. Everybody knows tripod, right? You put your cameras on it, it's got 3 feet. Tetra is going to be four-footed, and sure enough, it has, well, it has more like two sections that hold up the whole thing, but I suppose we count it as four-footed. And so this is the first year I've had this icon to put out, because I found among some of the Orthodox they were producing it, so I was able to get a copy of it. It is not Jacob's ladder. Some people have asked about that. It is the icon of the divine ladder. And what it is actually portraying artistically, iconographically, is a book called The Ascent of the Divine Ladder, written by St. John Climacus. And St. John was one of the first abbots of the monastery of St. Catherine of Mount Sinai, established by the Emperor Justinian back in the 500s. It is one of two monasteries. One is in Switzerland, and the other is, of course, this St. Catherine's on Mount Sinai, which are the only two religious communities that have had continual occupation and residency by the religious since the beginning. They were founded of 1,500 years. And so they just recently, both of these monasteries, celebrated their 15th centenary. And so the monastery, of course, commemorates the giving of the law on Mount Sinai and has the relics of St. Catherine the Philosopher there. And St. John was one of the first abbots. And he wrote a work of the 33 steps to arrive at beatitude. And it is considered he wrote it for the religious specifically, and it is the classic Lenten reading for the Eastern Church religious. I mean, everyone can read it. And it is a magnificent book. It is very intense. And so the icon is portraying the ascent that is taking place is a ladder. You will notice in the icon, in the upper corner, you have the angels. In other words, down below in the other corner with the men who are sheltered. They're actually enclosed by this rock formation. When you see the icons, you'll see oftentimes people on earth are portrayed in front of something closed, either a building that's roofed or a stone cliff in front behind them, because it shows that they are still locked into this valley of tears. But when you see the icon of the resurrection, those rocks are only on the side, and our Lord in his glory is in the middle of open because there is this breaking through of the transformation that is given in the new creation, as he also pulls Adam up. But that's for next month. What the icon of the divine ladder is showing is the monks who are suspended between those fully in the valley of tears and the angelic. And their intent is in that ascetical effort to collaborate with the invitation of grace and to ascend towards our Lord's invitation. So at the top of the ladder, we have our Lord. And through the opening of this divine transcendence, inviting them. And you notice at the bottom of the ladder, there are many of them all bunched up. It's easy to start, right? You can always have that room that's never been quite finished in painting or something else. It's easy to start a project, to see it all the way through the end. Sometimes it doesn't happen. But you'll notice at the top of the ladder, there are fewer and fewer monks actually there. And of course, what everyone seems to really notice first is because the monks are actually falling off at a rather rapid rate, not just into the Valley of Tears, they're actually being drawn down by the demons into the bowels of hell. So it's a sobering icon. I've had for years a copy of it hanging next to my bed in my room to remember. But that was just a framed print, so it's actually framed. This was an icon that I wanted to make sure, because we had nothing specific for Lent to put out. And it's a reminder that every day that we're alive, you up the ante. The kitty becomes a little more piled up, and the stakes are greater because there's one more day of grace, one more day of invitation, one more day of possibilities of transfiguration within the Sacred Heart. And if we piddle it away, that's one more day that the devil's prongs get a little bit bigger to be able to pull us down because we've ignored that invitation. So the icon is very descriptive and at the same time very simple as to what our whole Catholic life is meant to be about. So all I wanted to do is finish with today is to, we talk about this whole conversion process. So we've talked about it in the last 2 weeks. But liturgically is really where we started because I've been trying to describe to you the Mass. And of course, liturgically, as I pointed out to you in the beginning, we don't have any form of a confiteor, I confess to Almighty God to you, because it is the incense ceremony, as I mentioned to you. So we consider the incense, its symbolism, what it actually means. But now we come to the very core of what the actual ceremony is about. And you can open up your missals if you want to follow. The words themselves are not, in fact, we're having the discussion now among the priests, so when we do the next edition of the missals, that the actual words for these parts of the liturgy be placed in the book instead of just having text one after the other. Because we call the incense ceremony the husoyo. And the reason why that word is important, because it's the Aramaic word translating something from the Old Testament. And in the Old Testament, We have the Ark of the Covenant, and over the Ark you have these two images of the cherubim, which are with their wings covering the top of this gold-covered box, essentially is what it is. That space over the Ark was known to the Hebrews as kaporet. Sometimes it's translated as propitiatory. Sometimes it's translated as the place of expiation. It symbolized God's presence in the Holy of Holies. The Greeks wound up using this and calling their translation for it was ilasterion. The ilasterion is an instrument of expiation. That's how they're trying to translate this word, kaporet, which is actually describing a space over a box. So it's quite mysterious. In the Aramaic, the term is husoio, propitiation. St. Paul will use this in the fourth chapter of the letter to the Hebrews, when he says, "Let us now then with great confidence have access to the throne of mercy." He's echoing this idea of the Holy of Holies, the place where God is represented by these things within the temple, but only symbols. It's not God's personal presence in the sense other than representing his presence. So, of course, when the Lord God himself enters into our time, enters into human history, he is not just simply represented as a space over a golden box, but he himself is now present as our expiation. That is husoio. And that is why what the Aramaic Christianity, Catholicism, did was the ceremony then becomes linked with the divine and living altar, because it is Christ who is our place of expiation. And so in the Syriac tradition, the insistence is upon these prayers of purification and of forgiveness, which is the husoio, which is why any major ceremony that we have always has an incense ceremony. Most people, when they first come across, they're like, well, the incense smells really pretty. But that's not really the reason why it's used. I mean, that's a nice aspect to it, but it's not the essence of the reason. So that what we do in the husoio is we break it down. That's why I said, if you want to look in your books, you can find it on the pages. Because the very first introduction, literally, we call it the praemion. And it is a prayer, it's a preface, introducing us to what we're now going to do in this whole conversion process before the Lord. So it has a preface and acts as a doxology to the praise of the God who brings us expiation and forgiveness. Now, before this ceremony, we used to recite Psalm 50, the famous Miserere, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your great mercy." Sometimes numbered, classically it's numbered 50. Sometimes you'll see it in the newer translations as 51 listed in the Psalms. Every manuscript of every Maronite historical in all times have always had this psalm recited because it's part of the expiation every day. Now, what is interesting about it, of course, is you don't have it in the book. We haven't been doing it. That was part of the streamlining. So right now you're here stuck for an hour and 15, hour and a half each Sunday. It would have been closer to 2 hours. So some of the things, and that gives you an example of what was removed. I suppose that will be discussed again if it winds up being replaced. But it seems that in the minds of those who did that the husoio ceremony and Psalm 50, in a sense, were redundant because they were both expiation. So it's just to keep in mind that when they sing so beautifully in Lent, the Erhamni, after peace be with the church and her people, normally you had Psalm, and specifically Psalm 50, that would be recited as part of the expiation. But that is the first introduction then we have is the praemion, which is an introduction, a preface, and a doxology. Then you have the long prayer. And again, on this point, they used to be much longer. Sometimes it'd be an entire page and a half. In Aramaic, we call that part of the ceremony sedro, S-E-D-R-O, sedro. Cedro in Aramaic means series, ranking, listing. And the reason why it's called Cedro, and this is really the essential prayer of the whole Syriac tradition, because what it does, it has two parts to it. The first part of it, and oftentimes it's broken up this way in paragraphs. It doesn't mean there's only two paragraphs, but it has a theme in all of them which is twofold and being proper to the tradition of Antioch. The first part of the Cedro is on praise and thanksgiving. It usually gives you the theme of what's happening. Feast of the Annunciation. So here you talk about the prodigal son, the mercy of God, God's compassion, and his desire for sinners to convert. Because that's our meditation and what we're doing here liturgically. And so in the Cedro, you first have this praise and thanksgiving, or a sense about theme. And the reason why this is proper to the Antiochian tradition is because this is very much linked historically, almost certainly, with the Baracha, this blessing, or the Barachata. The Jewish blessings, the 18 blessings, these blessings that would be given, is very much a foundation of this Husoyu. And so the 18 blessings that would be given in the synagogue are a foundation of this idea that we give praise and thanksgiving of something. And then the second part is basically, therefore. Please grant us this, 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 and this. Grant us conversion. Grant us a knowledge to know ourselves, for example, in today's prayer. That's the series and the ranking. Grant us these graces. Those who have lost their way, those who are wandering, we ask, therefore, that you bring them back. Bring them, soften their hearts that they may repent, convert, turn to you, know you, and come to love you. That is Cedro. So it's the prayer of intercession as why we are converting, why we stand before the Lord to bow in our repentance to turn towards the Lord. That is the essence of the ceremony. Then you have the hymn, which is becoming more and more beautifully sung. Thank you for the flute. I know it's embarrassing, but it's a wonderful thing. It is a great help to us also. Thank you. So we call that kolo. In English, we call it a hymn, but it's technically in Aramaic, we call it kolo. Kolo actually means voice in Aramaic, kolo. And so, or melody, we could translate it. This is now the thing that we sing in praise. The incensation ceremonies would normally take place during the Cedro, but there's just one of me. And so, without a deacon, we can't do them overlapping. So I do the incensations during the kolo, which is perfectly fine. It's just that normally you have this hymn of the exuberant heart in its conversion towards God and thanking him for this forgiveness and expiation which has been brought to us within our divine Lord. That is why the response is of the voice to sing praise to God in kolo. And so you have the hymn, but you'll notice that the incensation is also not like the Latin church. We're not incensing the altar by walking around it to incense it. If you pay attention, we're actually incensing the four corners of the altar. And sometimes the priest will stand in one place, or the deacon will stand in the front of the altar and incense the four corners and not necessarily walk around. But historically, we've always walked around it to the four corners. And what this is echoing is in the old law again, that when you brought your holocaust, you brought your sacrifices and animals were killed. The killing was not the sacrifice. What was being sacrificed after it was killed was actually presented before the altar. And in the great sacrifices of expiation, the blood from the animal was taken and anointed on the four corners, or the four horns of the altar, they call it. Because the corners of this altar, which was square block, the corners of the altar were raised. And the blood would go on the corner of each of these places, on this raised corner of the altar, the blood would be anointed on it. And so reflecting again the symbolism of the Old Testament, of the Holy of Holies, of the place, the kaporet, the place of expiation, who saw your being the true and one God in his incarnation, the true expiation of our sins, representing then in the living altar, which is our Lord. The altar is incensed with that symbol of atonement, which is the fragrance of the incense at the four corners. So you see, there's a lot of stuff that goes on, all simultaneously. And that's why when it's done, everyone is incensed, because everyone becomes, by their baptism, members of that one reality, which is the incarnate Christ, the incarnate Word. So the altar, if there were priests present here, the ministers, they are incensed, then the servers are incensed, and the entire congregation is incensed, because you are the church. The bricks, the ceiling, that's not the church. It's a building so we don't have main snow dumping on our head throughout the winter. You are the church which gives a name to this building that we call church. And therefore, the incensation of the whole congregation is because it are the members of the one Christ who is our husoio. And that's why it's often, I mean, normally our rubric now says sit. But normally, historically, you would be standing for that prayer. And the incensation would be, as we always do, these profound bows before this forgiveness and a sign of our repentance. And now, in order for us to finish, we can talk about that last prayer, which is very simple to understand now. It is called etro. Etro. Usually spelled E. Etro, there's actually one of these choking letters in front of it, ayin. But so it's etro actually means fragrance, perfume. And what it is the closing prayer for that of gratitude, and usually a kind of a summary of what we're asking for as the incense ascends in this place for the forgiveness of our sins. And so it very beautifully is called etro. It is also known as hutomo, hutomo. And hutomo is translated often English as ending, but more properly it means seal, impress, the finish, and something that is meant to be lasting in its representation. That is the ceremony of conversion. That is why we don't do a confiteor. We do much, much, much more. But it means that when this ceremony begins to take place, I'm thinking, as we stand before the husoio, the fragrance of creation, who is the Christ, my mind is meant to be, I am dishonest, I lie, I'm impure, I have been unkind, uncharitable, harsh, and impatient. All the things that I know within my heart of hearts that I need to be expiated are the things that I bring to this part of the liturgy. And to understand its profound beauty, it links very well on this Sunday with the idea of try, prove yourselves, show that Christ is working within you. Because St. Paul says, then just a few lines later, he says, because in the end, we can do nothing against what is true. We can bash our heads against it. We can scream. We can throw fits. We can try to manipulate. But St. Paul says, we can do nothing against the truth. Only for the truth. And I've used that image before. It's always going to be God's game. And it's always going to be God's rules. In nature and in the order of grace. We can't change that. Period. We are going to glorify God one way or the other, either by his justice, following into the black pits of hell, or in his mercy, because we have stood before the divine husoio and asked for the conversion and the strengthening of our hearts. So try yourselves. If you be within the faith, prove yourselves and show that Christ dwells within you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified on Pontius Pilate, and suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who first speaks from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy
Catholic and apostolic church. We confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Itelvot madebheda loho, valvot arloho dal haretayut, veinutsugot aivutot, keul albay tochves kodeb chayeklo, od kodesho. Avnai mitul mohoran.
Alo, kakeshu toro, yekha amnama asto.
Almighty Lord and God, you accepted the offerings of our ancestors. Now accept these offerings that your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon us, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your imperishable kingdom. As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, the Chosen One, our Holy Father, Saint Mary and Saint Jude, and the sleepers of Ephesus. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
Continue with the anaphora of Saint John the Evangelist on page 815. 815. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord God and Father, you are true love, security that is ever sure, and hope that never fails. Grant love, happiness, and everlasting peace to your children here before you. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with pure hearts and souls, and with a holy kiss worthy of your blessed name, that we may raise glory to you only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, O holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O server of the Holy Spirit. Let us give the greeting of peace to our neighbor, with love and faith that are pleasing to God. Bow before your majesty, send us your grace and glorious blessings from the heights of your heavenly sanctuary, that we may glorify you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Lord, you sent your beloved Son at the appointed time for our salvation, and he gave us these holy and life-giving mysteries. Do not look upon us as strangers, and do not turn your holy face away from us because of our many sins. For you alone are the Holy One, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The love of God the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship him with humility. It is right and just to praise you, O Lord of all in heaven and on earth. The powers on high in the heavens where they dwell glorify you. The fiery ranks exalt you, the cherubim bless you, and the seraphim worship you. They cry out and they proclaim.
Thank you.
holy, O God, the Father, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, one and indivisible in nature, and you sanctify all things by your divine power. For our salvation you sent your Son into the world. He descended, became flesh, suffered and was crucified for us, who had distorted his image. Kyrie eleison. Vabiamo haudoctum hasho dilema bedhaye. Ansabe lachmo midau korishoto. Ubarach ukodesh. Vaksuya biltar midau karomara. Sabachula mehne kulchu hono denita fachorodil dachlofaikun wachlof sagie metakaseu metihem chusoyon homewo hoyedan alam alamin. Alukoso domzicho men hamrohu men mayo. Barachu kodesh. Yabil talmida karomara. Sabestawa mehne kulchu. Hono denita. Demohondila diati ki chadato. Dachlofaikun wachlof sagiem. Mete shadu meti heb, husoyon hame wa hoyed an alam alami. Do this in memory of me, for whenever you eat this body and drink this blood, you proclaim my death until I come again. Christ our God, we remember your plan of salvation and we implore your goodness. When you come in glory with your holy angels and all await the reward they deserve, and when you place the sheep to the right and the goats to the left, do not look upon us as strangers to your household, and do not turn your holy face away from us. Do not let our sins and offenses pierce your holy heart, and do not separate us from you. For we have professed your holy name and have proclaimed your divinity. Rather, treat us according to your promises. Forgive our sins, pardon us, and have mercy upon your inheritance. For this your repentant church implores you, and through you and with you, implores your Father, saying, Lord, as we, your sinful children, receive your graces, we thank you for them, and because of them, Annin morio, annin morio, annin morio, nite mor rocho chayu korisho, o nachen alainu alu korvono hono. Thank you.
no dabmach no nutel na'bed lachmo no fagro dam shiho ala odilan. Ulam so ho dab koso no dimodile dam shiho ala odilan. May these holy mysteries sanctify the bodies and souls of those who share in them, cleanse their hearts, purify their thoughts, and be a pledge of the heavenly kingdom and new life forever.
Amen.
O Lord, we now remember in this sacrifice all the holy churches and the shepherds of the true faith, especially Francis, the Pope of Rome, Shout out Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Gregory John, our Bishop, and all the bishops. With them we remember the priests, the deacons, and all who serve your church. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace and stability of the whole world, for a blessed and prosperous year, for an abundant harvest, for the sick and the oppressed, for all who call upon your holy name, on land, at sea, or in the air, and who profess that you are the true God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, those who have presented the offering upon this altar, and those who desire to do so but were unable, and grant them their petitions. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We remember all the saints, the fathers, prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, Mary, the Mother of God, Saint Joseph, Saint Jude, Saint Maron, and the seven sleepers of Ephesus, and all the righteous and the just. Through their prayers, make us worthy to stand among them. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, in your grace, those who have left us and have gone to you from the first Christian disciples to this day. They were signed with the seal of baptism and received the precious body and blood of your Son. They wait for you in your life-giving hope. Raise them up on the last day, and in your mercy forgive all their sins. To our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs. Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Oblation, who offered yourself for us. You are the forgiving sacrifice, who offered yourself to your Father. You are the high priest, who offered yourself to us. Through your mercy, take care of our prayers and our sins.
God the Father, you accept prayers and you answer petitions. Taught us through your beloved Son to stand before you and to call upon you with pure souls and clear consciences, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Deliver us, O Lord, from every temptation and from harm of evil. For you have power over all, and we raise glory to you now and forever. Peace be with you. O Lord, in your grace and abundant mercy, bless those who bow before you. Make us worthy to share in your life-giving mysteries and to join the assembly of your saints, that with them we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever. Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord, our God, to you be glory.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and we raise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us. Gracious God and Father, how can we repay you for your goodness and for the salvation you have just given us? Who can give you the glory you truly deserve? In our weakness and insofar as we are able, we worship, praise, and thank you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our God, we worship, thank, and praise you. We implore your goodness and abundant mercy for the salvation of the whole world, for the protection of the living and eternal rest to the departed, for the feeding of the hungry and the support of the needy, for the visiting of the sick and the consolation of the grieving. Through your grace, dwell in them, and by your abundant mercy, give them life. By your luminous cross, bless your people and protect your inheritance. Adoration is due to you, to your Father, and to your holy and life-giving Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever. Amen.